Good afternoon to all the regional directors and students of post basic BSc nursing second year. This is the second session of teleconferencing in which we will be discussing about BNS 107 block 1 unit 5 care of low birth weight babies. So before we start this session, I would like to request all the regional directors to kindly send the attendance of the students who are attending this session. So we will start. We have with us Professor Pretty Kaul, professor in School of Health Sciences, IGNU, and I welcome Madam Surekha Sama. She is principal in School of Nursing at Deen Dayal Upadhyay, New Delhi. So I welcome all two of you. And then the low birth weight baby is the topic of the today's discussion. So Madam, would you like to define low birth weight babies as well as the causes of the low birth weight?
Okay. Low birth weight babies are special group of newborns. They need special attention and special nursing care to sustain their life. These low birth weight babies are an important and main cause of one of the main causes of neonatal and infant mortality and morbidity. About 80% of the neonatal deaths take place in the low birth weight babies. Therefore, these babies need a special attention and special care of the nursing professionals. These babies are also, the low birth weight is also an important cause of malnourished babies during the first year of the life. So, what are the low birth weight babies? The low birth weight baby could be either low birth weight, they could be very low birth weight, or they could also be extremely low birth weight. So let us see what is the low birth weight baby. A baby who weighs less than 2,500 grams at birth, irrespective of the gestational age, is a low birth weight baby. And what is extremely or what is very low birth weight baby? A baby who weighs less than 1,500 grams at birth is a very low birth weight baby. And a baby who weighs less than 1,000 grams at birth is an extremely low birth weight baby. So these babies can be categorized in various classifications. So let us see what are the classifications. These babies could be either preterm, they could be small for date or growth retarded babies, or they could be both small for date and preterm babies. So there are mainly three classifications of low birth weight babies. The first could be preterm. What is preterm? The babies who are born before 37 weeks of gestation and they have normal intrauterine growth and they weighed between 10th and 90th percentile at the growth of their mean growth weight. And what are the small for date babies? Small for date babies are born at term. They are born at term, but their growth is retarded. They have slow growth retarded. They have slow intrauterine growth. Their intrauterine growth is retarded and they weigh less than 10th percentile below their mean weight of the age. So the other category of the babies are both. They are both preterm as well as intrauterine growth retardation. These babies are born before 37 weeks of gestation and also have intrauterine growth retardation. That means they have grown very slowly during the intrauterine life and have therefore low birth weight. So let us see what is the incidence of low birth weight babies. In India, the low birth weight accounts for 30 to 40% of all births. And out of these, preterm babies are 8 to 10% and small for date babies are 20 to 30% of the babies. But since this 30% constitutes a large number of babies in India we take into consideration the babies who are born less than 2,000 grams for the admission. Because in India we have lack of resources and there is large number of the babies who are low birth weight babies, so they cannot be given care into the neonatal nurseries because of the lack of resources. And it is also in view of considering their relative mortality and morbidity patterns and also the lack of resources, the India we consider 2,000 grams as the low birth weight babies. So therefore, for the connotation of Indian system, we take 2,000 and we give admit to the neonatal nursery these babies who weigh 2,000 grams. Then, what are the causes of these babies? I think this, the causes are written in your book, 115 page. I will just read them out and then we'll discuss about these causes. These are spontaneous premature onset of labor, poor socio-economic status, antepartum hemorrhage, cervical incompetence, bicornuate uterus, multiple pregnancy. That is for preterm babies. If we talk of small for dead babies, they are maternal malnutrition, chronic systemic maternal illness, placental dysfunction, toxemia of pregnancy, hypertension, genetic and chromosomal disorders, intrauterine infections. And about preterm babies, congenital malformation, young unmarried mothers, maternal diabetes mellitus, severe Rh isoimmunization. And about the small for dead babies, multiple pregnancy, maternal smoking and narcotic addiction. These are in general the causes of low birth weight babies, which include both preterm as well as small for dead babies. But if you analyze these causes, you will find that the causes of low birth weight relates to either the maternal conditions or the placental conditions or the fetal conditions. These are the main three important areas which relate, which contribute to the cause of low birth weight baby. And if we talk in general about the causes of low birth weight babies, we can discuss which could be common for both for small for date as well as preterm babies. What are these causes which are common for both and where the babies are more likely to get low birth weight as well as preterm? This is birth defects. The first one is birth defects. The birth defects, the child, the newborn who is born with the birth defects is likely to be born prematurely and also is likely to be likely to have low birth weight, because due to genetical problems and also the structural abnormalities during the intrauterine life, the child's growth is retarded. Hence, they are likely to be prematurely born and also they are likely to be small for dead babies. The other important area is chronic health problems in the mother. There are certain health problems in the mother, like we can say diabetes, we can say hypertension, we can say other cardiac, renal and lung diseases, which can lead to the growth retardation of the babies and also the prematurity in babies. Then the other area is smoking. The smoking is also very important, because the nicotine present in the smoking, when the mothers, pregnant mothers smoke, that causes the slow growth of the fetus inside the uterus during the intrauterine period and also thus causing the low birth weight as well as premature delivery. Then there is also the alcoholism and the drugs also. There are certain drugs also, when the mother is taking alcohol or certain drugs during the pregnancy, then that can affect the intrauterine growth and the baby can be prematurely born. Then the most important thing is infections in the mother. The mother, if has certain infections, maybe the infections in the uterus, the infections in the cervix, or the febrile conditions of other diseases, if the mother has, the mother is likely to have a baby which is prematurely born, or the baby also, that could, the baby could also have the problems in prematurely and the birth weight. Then is the infection of fetus. We have already said that if we analyze the causes, the cause lies with the mother, the fetus and the placenta. The fetal infections are very important. During the intrauterine life, there are torch group of infections which can lead to premature as well as the low birth weight baby. And these torch infections are nothing. This is toxoplasmosis. Others include syphilis, malaria, tuberculosis, ophthalmia neonatorum and other diseases. R is rubella, C is cytomegalovirus virus and H is herpes. So then these are the infections which can lead to the low birth weight. Then the placental problem. Placental problems are one of the important causes of even premature as well as the low birth weight, because the supply of nutrition and the supply of oxygenated blood to the fetus is diminished during the intrauterine life. So that leads to the slow birth weight as well as the prematurity in the babies. Then inadequate maternal weight gain. You know, if there are certain reasons when the mothers do not gain the weight during the pregnancy, 10 to 12 kgs of weight are to be increased during the intrauterine life. But if the mother does not increase the weight and the baby is likely to be very slow born and also sometimes prematurity, they can deliver prematurely also. Then the most important factor is socioeconomic status in our country. The socioeconomic status in our country is very poor and there is lack of education among mothers. And And if the lack of education and the poor socio-economic status does not allow them to take care of themselves during the pregnancy period, and hence the baby born is very small, and this becomes a vicious circle of the life. Then if the small baby is born, if a baby girl is born who is small, she will also grow a small child and small girl child, and then when she gets married, she becomes pregnant, she will again give birth to a small baby. So this becomes a sort of a vicious circle. So these are in nutshell the general common causes of the low birth weight babies and the premature babies, which we have discussed. Then we go to the characteristics of the low birth. Would you like to add something, Madam Surekha?
No, I think you have covered them very well. What are the causes which are common for both occurrence of preterm and small for date, and you have also covered the causes which separately are responsible for preterm and SFD babies. So
okay, then we'll go to the characteristics of the low birth weight babies. So the basic physical, if we talk about the basic physical characteristics of the babies, we talk about the weight, the length, the head circumference and the chest circumference. The weight is always less than 2500 grams, which we have already discussed. The length is less than 47 centimeters. The head circumference is less than 33 centimeters. And the chest circumference is less than head circumference. And that is less by more than 3 centimeters. If we see the appearance of these babies, their activity is very poor and their attitude is relaxed. They are relaxed and because they have low muscle tone and they are very sluggish. They have their legs are extended and they have shrill or weak cry. They cannot cry vigorously. They don't have a vigorous cry even at birth and after the birth. And they have sluggish reflexes, or the sucking, swallowing and moro reflex is very sluggish. If we talk about the skin, their skin is red, that is shining, loose and very delicate. They have very less subcutaneous fat. They have abundant lanugo, which are the hair at the back of the baby's back and the back of the head. Then there is also scanty vernix caseosa. All the times the veins are visible over the abdomen and the scalp of the head of the baby. If we go to the head, characteristics of the baby, of the head, you will see the head of the baby is, if I show you the figure, okay, last I'll show you if you see the baby's head, it is large as compared to rest of the bodies. And if you also look at the bones of the skull bones of the baby, they are very soft. You can just palpate those bones. They are very, very soft if you just palpate. And the sutures and fountains are very wide because they are not they have not fused. The hair is scanty and they are very fully and woolly and fuzzy. Each hair fiber can be separated. They can be separately seen. And the face is small, chin and face is very small. The eyes are protruding and the buccal pad of fat is absent in these babies. There are four important characteristics in the babies which can tell you that whether the baby is a small for date baby or the baby is a preterm baby. These four important characteristics are, if we talk about the breast nodules. So one of the first important character which differentiates a baby from a low birth weight and a premature baby is breast nodule. If you see a premature baby, the breast nodule is absent, or sometimes it may be less than 4 millimeters in diameter. If you look at the areola of the baby's areola is flat. And if you look at the nipples of the baby, the nipple may not be even visible, or sometimes it may be very flat. So the breast nodule is very important. The other important criteria for assessing the babies is ear cartilage. Can you show me the next picture of the book? Next page picture of the book? Can you show me the next page? Yeah, this one. This picture. So if you see the upper one babies, the ear cartilage is very well developed. And if you fold this, if you fold the pinna or the external ear of the baby, the ear will immediately recoil. That is in case of the term baby who is low birth weight but is a term baby. Can you show the B? And you can also see, as I earlier talked, that these babies have individual hair follicles, can be individual hair fibers can be seen. And if you fold the ear of this baby in these in the preterm babies, the ear cartilage is not well developed, and if you fold the pinna of the ear, it doesn't recoil. It remains folded for quite some time, and it gets recoiled very poorly. It doesn't recoil immediately as you fold it. The other important characteristics, lanugo, as we already discussed, this is appendix here on the back and face of the baby, which are low birth weight. Can you show the first page of the figure? First page of the figure? Please show the first page of the figure. This side one. Yeah, these two figures. You can show these two figures simultaneously. See, if we see the figure A, you can see the sole creases are very deeply, there are deep sole creases. There are many sole creases, and they are deep creases, and you can also identify these sole creases. So this shows that the baby is term, but baby may be low birth weight baby, but the baby is term. If you see the next picture, you see the sole looks like flat. Only superficial creases are looking. We can see only the superficial creases over this sole. So that means the baby is a preterm baby. The baby is born prematurely, and the sole creases are not well developed. Can you show the next figure? So this is very important. Other important characteristics where we can differentiate the babies' genitalia from the low birth weight as well as the small for dead babies. See, if you see the genitalia, if you see the scrotum of these babies, it is very well developed, and the testes is descended in the scrotum, and there are enough of rugae. The linings are there, the creases which are around the this scrotum, they are very well seen and they are very well present. So that means scrotum is very well developed in the full term low birth weight babies. But if you see these genitals of male in the low birth weight, please show second one, B. You can just see the rugae is not very well developed, the testes is not distended, and this is not non-pendulous. The scrotum is non-pendulous in case of preterm babies. Can you show the next figure? See, this is the female genitalia of a term low birth weight baby. The genitalia in the low birth weight babies are well developed. The labia majora covers the labia minora, and the clitoris is not prominent in this baby, as you can see. If you see the second picture, see, you can see the labia minora and labia majora are quite apart. The labia majora does not cover the labia minora, and the clitoris is very prominent in this baby. So this is baby, in case of preterm babies, the labia minora is labia majora is not covering the labia minora. So these are the very important figures. These are very important points, as we talked about the breast nodule, the ear cartilage, the sole creases, the genitalia, the lanugo, and other characteristics which can differentiate between the low birth weight baby as well as preterm baby. So I think I have covered the basic criteria.
Yeah, very well covered about the symptoms of the low birth weight baby and how it differentiates from the normal full-term baby. So this is very nicely discussed, and I would like to ask Madam Surekha Sama about the physiology of the handicap of low birth weight babies.
Compared to the physical characteristics of the newborn, both small for dead and preterm babies, we can now discuss and talk on certain physiological handicaps which the baby has. Because of the short of time, I will cover the management and the nursing care points also side by side. The physiological handicaps which are given in your book, if we enumerate them, there are about 7 to 8 of them.
They can show the slide. Can you show the slide?
Starting from head, if we look at it, the baby's neurological functions are depressed because they are not fully developed. The respiratory center of the baby is immature. The heat regulating center is not working effectively. With the result, the baby's temperature is not maintained. These babies otherwise also have less of subcutaneous fat and less of brown fat. Their ability to generate heat with metabolism of the brown fat is lessened, so they are more prone to hypothermia. These babies have immaturity of the respiratory center also, so they and their muscle tone is very poor. They are usually using diaphragmatic muscles to take respirations, and the intercostal recessions are very strong. Even otherwise, the alveoli, which are covered by cuboidal cells, which otherwise help in air exchange, are not there. So these babies, the cellular structure of the air cells or the alveoli is also not effectively made, by which the there is tendency for the less air exchange between the lungs and the capillary blood. The other reason for these babies to have respiratory difficulties, they have less of surfactant. Surfactant is a kind of a lipoprotein which is present normally in the air cells and which prevents the air cells to get compressed or fully emptied out. So the alveoli, which are otherwise inflated with the air, should not get deflated completely, because to inflate them again, the baby requires more of effort. Even otherwise, if the baby is born with respiratory difficulty and is requiring resuscitation, it is vigorous resuscitation which is required. So hyperventilation would be required to reinflate those air cells which were otherwise deflated because of lack of surfactant. So these problems put these babies at risk for developing respiratory distress, hairline membrane disease, hypoxia, acidosis, late onset of acidosis, and baby's nutrition is also affected, because the GI system in general is also not mature enough. The liver is not able to detoxify the drugs. There is deficiency of gluconyl transferase enzyme. So this baby's ability to digest the proteins and the fats is also lessened. The baby's ability to detoxify the drugs which are given is also lessened. There is small capacity of the stomach. The baby cannot be given more of feed. There is esophageal reflux, with which the chances of regurgitation are there. The baby's cardiac sphincter is not functioning well. The normal nutrition of the baby is totally disturbed. Because the baby has had less of gestation, the mother has already suffered malnutrition, the baby has suffered malnutrition in intrauterine life. So because of which their iron reserves are less, the baby is more prone to have nutritional deficiencies like vitamin E, vitamin D, iron, folic acid, which again put the baby at a nutritional risk for maintaining their normal metabolic requirements. In addition, the baby also has renal insufficiency, which means that the kidneys are not able to function effectively. The solute load in the kidneys cannot be taken up, because the solutes which are of high osmolar level cannot be passing from the Bowman's capsule into the tubular secretions. So the babies are not able to excrete those toxic substances, which are either of metabolic waste of the nutrition, or they are the detoxification substances of the drugs. So the baby is at risk for having more of toxemia if carefully the drug choice is not made, or the dose of the drug is given heavy, or the frequency of the drugs is given at a rapid time. If large quantities of drugs are given in aliquots, then also the baby is more prone to have problems. The baby has in general low protein levels in the blood, because of which the baby is likely to have edema developed in the body. And these babies are otherwise also more prone to dehydration, because the skin is very thin, and these babies are generally, because of their handicaps, they are kept in incubator or radiant warmer where the evaporative losses are more. Even the baby is put on intravenous fluids and enteric feeds, the humidified atmosphere at environmental temperature and high humidity level in the nursery or the intensive care unit also puts the baby at risk for infections. So as it is, we have seen that baby has many handicaps. In addition to all this, baby has less of immunity also. The baby does not get enough of immunity, and there is deficiency of immunoglobulins in the blood. IgG levels are low, because of which the baby is more prone to infection. On top of the inbuilt less of immunity, the baby is also prone to infection because of more handling, because of the invasive procedures, vigorous resuscitation which starts right at birth. If the mother has had some intrauterine infections, as Madam Kaul was saying, torch group of infection can result into SFD preterm babies. So these babies have already suffered some kind of infection, or if there has been a premature rupture of membranes, there has been an open track for infection for the baby. And in the intrauterine life itself, the baby might have suffered some sort of infection or exposed to infection. On top of that, when the baby is born in the extrauterine life also, the baby is getting more exposed to infection. So with the result, the baby becomes more prone to having high morbidity rate. The baby's glucose level cannot be maintained, because of hypoglycemia, the baby can get hypothermic. Because of acidosis, the baby can get hypothermic. The liver function, as I was telling you, the baby's bilirubin levels can also not be controlled well by the liver deficiency because of gluconeal deficiency. The level of bilirubin can be shown at a lower level. There can be more of damage to the nerve cells of the nerve cells, because the bilirubin level can damage the brain cells. The ability of the baby's blood-brain barrier is also reduced, which in a normal baby would not allow the bilirubin to cross the blood-brain barrier and cause the basal ganglia to get pigmented with the bilirubins. These babies, because of low blood-brain barrier, can get more prone to hyperbilirubinemia and kernicterus, which can result into encephalopathy. So the baby's in general ability to cope up with the problems and the extraneous problems is much lessened, and that is why these babies need extra care. More of these babies, as soon as they are born, they start requiring extra skilled care, and it is better that prevention of all these problems can be planned, well planned. As long as the baby's premature birth can be prevented. If it can be prevented, then it is much more better survival for the baby. You would be learning more about that, but in just brief, I would mention some of the points how the baby's birth can be prevented early by with the advent of many medicines these days and better protocols of management. The mothers are given tocolytic agents by which the labor can be delayed, because of which the baby can be in utero and can gain more maturity. With the result, the lung maturity can be better, the nervous maturity, heat regulation center maturity can be better, and the baby once born, even instead of being at 35 weeks, if the baby's gestation can be extended to 37 weeks, then it is much better. So the baby's survival rate and complications because of immaturity can be prevented
but
in the newborn unit.
It is only if sometimes induced premature labor is desired because of the maternal and fetal condition, in those cases these drugs are not used.
Yes,
in those cases,
of course,
that is important.
If the mother's mother does not have any other complications and there is no warning to use tocolytic agents, they should not be used. But if there is no other warning and the labor, premature labor can be extended, then of course tocolytic will be used. Magnesium sulfate is the safest tocolytic agent because that does not depress the respiratory center to the extent like the other tocolytic agents would do. Even use of, they will have to be used carefully, like indomethacin can also be used, alpha beta receptors can also be used, but that obstetrician will have to think that which best is suited for the baby. Because if indomethacin is used, then also there are chances that it may close the patent ductus arteriosus and the baby's cardiovascular and cardiorespiratory function will be affected. So in that case, instead of being good to the baby, instead of doing good to the baby, we are harming the baby more. So the chances are there that the viability of the fetus will be reduced. So if they are to be used, they also have to be used very carefully. The other reason is that the other action that can be taken is that if within the utero environment, the baby can be the mother can be transferred to a safer place of delivery, so that we have facilities to take care of the resuscitation in case the baby is born with respiratory distress or asphyxia. Baby can be tackled well. So a level 2 care facilities should be available where the mother is referred for safe delivery. And it should be ensured that a skilled pediatrician and a skilled nursing personnel is present there with the beforehand facilities and preparation of the facilities in the labor room. The environmental temperature should be maintained between plus minus 30 degrees centigrade, and preformed bed sheet, the radiant warmer can be put on 30 minutes before the expected time of birth. The cord clamping can be delayed so that the baby gets little more of blood and iron reserves can be improved. So these are certain things which can be taken care of by the nursing personnel and the pediatrician on call.
The most important is that the resuscitatory preparations should be there.
Yes.
That is the first and foremost important thing which needs to be kept in the laboratory.
If the mother has shown any sign where the baby, the fetus has also shown signs of asphyxiation, there has been some fetal distress, then it is better that we prepare the resuscitation trolley. Even otherwise,
no,
I think for
fine.
All births,
all
the
births
resuscitation
have
to be prepared much before.
Yeah.
The ventilatory support should be ready in functioning order. The endotracheal tube should be put. And one thing I would stress here is that if the baby's birth weight is expected to be less than 1000 grams, then it is mandatory that all the babies born less than 1000 grams are put on endotracheal tube, because these babies would definitely require surfactant therapy, and prophylactically endotracheal tube is put, even though the baby might not have suffered any asphyxiation. So these kind of actions should needs to be planned at the time of birth. The other is that their temperature has to be maintained. It is the focus should be to maintain the core temperature at 36 degrees centigrade and the skin temperature at 35.5 degrees centigrade. The radiant warmers which are used in the newborn units, they should be put on beforehand. The heater output should be adjusted so that the baby's temperature, epigastric skin temperature, is maintained at between 35.5 to 36.5 degrees centigrade. And despite baby being under radiant warmer, it is necessary that their temperatures are checked in between to make sure that the probe is attached properly and the indication or the reading on the radiant warmer is correct. If the baby's color is pink, the baby is warm to touch and baby is otherwise looking stable, then it ensures that the baby is able to maintain the temperature. The other thing is that the baby can be dressed a little bit. The baby can be put on mittens if the permits and there are no IV lines there. The baby can have woolen socks and the baby can be put on head cap, woolen cap. The other rest of the baby can be naked. And it should be ensured that the baby's feeding is taken care of, because if the baby goes into hypoglycemia, the baby is likely to suffer more of hypothermia, because the baby cannot have metabolic thermogenesis. The nursing responsibility is to make sure that they ensure the proper functioning of the reindeer warmer and maintenance of the baby's temperature. Keep checking it in between and start the feeding within half an hour or within 1 hour. In case the baby is very premature, usually the babies would require IV fluids. If the baby is less than 1000 gram, the baby will definitely be put on intravenous infusion, and those babies can be put on 5% dextrose. If the baby is between 1000 gram to 1900 grams, the baby is put on intravenous fluids of 10% dextrose. And if the baby is more than 1800 grams and the gestation period is more than 35 weeks, usually the coordination of sucking and swallowing reflex develops by then, so these babies can be put on Katori feed, or if the baby is accepting the feeds well, the baby can be put on directly breastfeed. And these babies are usually having better survival. So
the best way of feeding is the pellet feeding.
Katori spoon or pellet feeding. Important nursing responsibility here is that they should make sure that if no formula feeds are used, because preterm babies are usually not able to tolerate. The composition of formula food is very different from the breast milk. So ejected breast milk can be used instead of giving formula feed to the baby. And as the baby's age increases, the IV fluid requirement decreases, and more of EBM can be given to the baby, and slowly the baby can be weaned off from the Katori or Palladi feeding, and baby can be put on the breastfeed.
That depends upon how the sucking and swallowing reflexes of the baby are.
As I mentioned, that when the baby's gestational age goes beyond 35 weeks, usually the coordination develops, and these babies can be put on direct breastfeed. In certain units, there is a practice of enteral feed. The babies, when they are on intravenous fluid also, the ejected breast milk can be given about 2 to 4 ml 4 times in a day. That improves their digestibility, it gives them better nutrition, and it reduces the chances of necrotizing enterocolitis in the babies. So important is here for the nurse to make sure that the baby doesn't develop any complications. So whenever if the baby is totally now on enteral feeds or baby is on EBM, the abdominal girth should be taken. If there at any time there is increase of more than 2 centimeters in abdominal girth, then it should be it's a warning sign that the baby is developing some complications, and that is usually necrotizing enterocolitis. If the baby so the best would be if the nurses are able to take care of the temperature maintenance of the baby and feeding of the baby, protect the baby from infection, give enough of stimulation to the baby by having low noise in the unit, giving some music therapy to the babies, and allowing the mother to touch, handle, and cuddle the baby. There will be less chances for mortality and morbidity for these babies. If the baby is maintaining pink color, maintaining warmth of the body, and baby is gaining about 10 to 15 grams of weight per kg per day, these are the good signs, and the baby can be then shifted from intensive care units to the step down unit. And once the mother is sure that the mother is able to take care of elimination needs of the baby, baby is accepting feeds of the mother directly from the breast, the baby can be then ready for discharge, where the mother can take the baby and totally take care of the baby at home.
So by very well explained by Madam Surekha Sama about the care of the low birth weight baby, and till the time he becomes stable, he can be shifted to the mother. So with that, we thank all of you for this teleconference session. Thank you very much.